Good morning, friends. In today's session, we are going to have a look at major themes in A Midsummer Night's Dream by William Shakespeare. Themes are central to understanding A Midsummer Night's Dream as a play and identifying Shakespeare's social and political commentary. Now, first of all, we'll talk about the major theme, that is of love, in a play, A Midsummer Night's Dream. The dominant theme in A Midsummer Night's Dream is love, a subject to which Shakespeare returns constantly in his comedies. Shakespeare explores how people tend to fall in love with those who appear beautiful to them. People we think we love at one time in our lives can later seem not only unattractive, but even repellent. For a time, this attraction to beauty might appear to be love at its most intense, but one of the ideas of the play is that real love is much more than mere physical attraction. At one level, the story of the four young Athenians asserts that although the course of true love never did run smooth, true love triumphs in the end, bringing happiness and harmony. At another level, however, the audience is forced to consider what an apparently irrational and whimsical thing love is, at least when experienced between youngsters. Now we'll talk about another major theme, that is of marriage. A Midsummer Night's Dream asserts marriage as the true fulfillment of romantic love. All the damaged relationships have been sorted out at the end of Act 4 and Act 5. Serves to celebrate the whole idea of marriage in a spirit of festive happiness. The triple wedding at the end of Act 4 marks the formal resolution of the romantic problems that have beset the two young couples from the beginning. Even Aegeus attempted to force his daughter to marry the man he had chosen to be her husband. The mature and stable love of Theseus and Hippolyta is contrasted with the relationship of Oberon and Titania, whose squabbling has such a negative impact on the world around them. Only when the marriage of the fairy king and queen is put right, can there be peace in their kingdom and the world beyond it. Now, we'll talk about another major theme, that is of appearance and reality. Another of the play's main themes is one to which Shakespeare returns to again and again in his work: the difference between appearance and reality. The idea that things are not necessarily what they seem to be is at the heart of A Midsummer Night's Dream and in the very little itself. A dream is not real, even though it seems so as so at the time we experience it. Shakespeare consciously creates the play's dreamlike quality in a number of ways. Characters frequently fall asleep and wake having dreamed, having had magic worked upon them so that they are in a dreamlike state, or thinking that they have dreamed. I have had a dream, past the wit of a man to say what dream it was. Much of the play takes place at night, and there are references to moonlight, which changes the appearance of what it illuminates. The difference between appearances and reality is also explored through the play within a play to particularly comic effect. The rude mechanicals completely fail to understand the magic of the theater, which depends upon the audience being allowed to believe, for a time at least, that what is being acted out in front of them is real. When Snug the Joiner tells the stage audience that he is not really a lion and that they must not be afraid of him, we laugh at this stupidity, but we also laugh at ourselves, for we know that he is not just a joiner pretending to be a lion, but an actor pretending to be a joiner, pretending to be a lion. Shakespeare seems to be saying, we all know that this play isn't real, but you are still sitting here and believing it. This is a kind of magic too. Now, we'll talk about another major theme. This is of order and disorder. A Midsummer Night's Dream also deals with the theme of order and disorder. The order of Aegeus' family is threatened because his daughter wishes to marry against his will. The social order to the state demands that a father's will should be enforced. When the city dwellers find themselves in the wood, away from their ordered and hierarchical society, order breaks down and relationships are fragmented. But this is comedy, and relationships are more happily rebuilt in the free atmosphere of the wood before the characters return to society. Natural order, the order of nature, is also broken and restored in A Midsummer Night's Dream. The row between the fairy king and queen results in the order of the seasons being disrupted. The spring, the summer, the chiding autumn, angry winter change their wonted liveries, and mazed world by their increase knows not which is which. Only after Oberon and Titania's reconciliation can all this be put right. Without the restoration of natural order, the happiness of the play's ending could not be complete. This is all about major themes in a play, A Midsummer Night's Dream by William Shakespeare. Now we'll have a look at major symbols and motifs in a play, A Midsummer Night's Dream. Symbols and motifs are key to understanding A Midsummer Night's Dream and identifying Shakespeare's social and political commentary. Now we'll talk about the major symbol, that is of moon. The dominant imagery in A Midsummer Night's Dream revolves around the moon and moonlight. The word moon occurs three times in the play's first nine lines of the play. The last of these three references in a most striking visual image, the moon like to silver bow, new bent in heaven. One reason for repeating such images is to create the atmosphere of night. Shakespeare's plays were mostly performed by daylight, and he had to create the idea of darkness or half light in the imagination of his audience. There were no lights to turn off or to dim. In addition, these repeated moon references work upon the audience by creating a dreamlike atmosphere. Familiar things look different by moonlight. They are seen quite literally in a different light. The moon itself is also a reminder of the passage of time and that all things, like its phases, must change. The more educated people in Shakespeare's audience would have also understood the mythological significance of the moon. The moon goddesses Luna and Diana were associated with chastity on the one hand and fertility on the other. Two qualities that are united in faithful marriage, which the play celebrates. Now we'll talk about another major symbol, and that is of animals. Animal images also appear many times in the play, reminding us of the wildness of the woods in which most of the play's action takes place, where an unaccompanied female would be at the mercy of wild beasts in a setting where the wolf behowls the moon. But this is a comedy. These dangers are not really threatening. The animal references are stylized and conventional. The only physical animals encountered by the characters are the less than half ass Nick Bottom and the totally artificial lion played by Snug. The animal references are included in the many images of the natural world that are associated with the fairy kingdom. These details emphasize the pretty delicacy of the fairies themselves and make the wood seem more real in the imagination of the audience. Oberon's "I know a bank" speech in Act 2, Scene 1, is just one example of this. Now, we'll talk about another symbol, that is of seeing. A Midsummer Night's Dream also contains many references to seeing, eyes and eyesight. These images serve a double purpose. The repetition reminds the audience of the difference between how things look and what they are, and that love is blind and beauty is in the eye of beholder. This is all about the major symbols and motifs in a play, A Midsummer Night's Dream by William Shakespeare. Thank you.